So first, I would like to thank the organizers for the kind invitation and the opportunity for me to give this talk here. So I would like to report on a work done together with Michał Heller, who is currently a postdoc in Amsterdam, and Przemek Witaszczyk, who is finishing his PhD back in Krakow, on exactly this topic, which perhaps as it stands now may seem a bit strange. So I will try to explain what it really means and what was the physical motivation for looking at this something like that. So the outline of my talk is as follows. First, I would like to just give a brief introduction to hydrodynamics. And here especially, I would like to concentrate on higher order hydrodynamics, which is perhaps not so commonly known, and emphasize the point that this is kind of a quintessential example of a long wavelength gradient derivative expansion approach to quantum field theory. Then I would like to go on and describe a couple of questions that we wanted to ask in this respect. What is the nature of this hydrodynamic expansion in some sense? Then I will move on and describe the methods that we used. So this will consist mainly of fluid gravity duality and in a special kinematical regime of boost invariant flow, which is a kind of symmetry assumptions on some particular flow of the plasma, which is simple enough to allow for very efficient computations, yet it is general enough so that it really contains a lot of physical information. And then I will move on and describe our key results. So first, what is hydrodynamics? It's well known that it's a universal kind of description of the long wavelength degrees of freedom in whatever. In fact, it is universal. It applies equally well at macroscopic and microscopic scales. The universality means that the general structure of the hydrodynamic description is the same for all systems. What only changes are some numerical coefficients, the transport coefficients, which depend on the concrete microscopic theory which we are interested in. And of course, currently the most relevant example for our community is the Krauglum plasma produced at Rick and LHC, because first of all, it's known that it's a strongly interacting system, so it's a beautiful opportunity for ADS-CFT, and also it's an example of the most perfect fluid, of course, with some shear viscosity known in nature. But here, I would like to look more on a more general, a more theoretical point of view at this nature of this hydrodynamic expansion. Namely, since we are looking at a long wavelength description, it is the same as a kind of gradient expansion on expansion in the number of derivatives. So we are dealing with a certain effective perturbative expansion, but not in a coupling constant, but in a number of derivatives. And the question that we wanted to ask is, what is the nature of such an expansion? We know a lot about perturbative expansion in coupling constant in various physical systems, quantum mechanics, field theory, and so on. We know very well whether it's when it's convergent, when it's not convergent, when it's asymptotic, when it's Borel-summable, what kind of singularities may appear. So we would like here to ask the same similar questions for this long wavelength description and expansion in the number of derivatives. So now I will move on and describe in more detail hydrodynamics and how this expansion in the number of derivatives appears in the hydrodynamic case. So what is hydrodynamics once more? So first of all, it concentrates just on the dynamics of the energy momentum tensor T mu nu. So we are only interested in the energy density and momentum flow, energy flow of the system. And it amounts to the assumption, which is really an assumption, that the whole T mu nu is completely described only in terms of five quantities, namely the three components of flow velocity, energy density and pressure. And the energy density and pressure are connected by some equation of state, which is equal to 3p for conformal fluids. And in all this talk, I will only consider conformal fluids and the special case of n equal to 4 super Young-Mills theory. Of course, this assumption does not hold for all physical phenomena. There are lots of physics contained in situations where T mu nu cannot be expressed in such form, even at the zeroth order. But I will restrict myself to this type of behaviors. Now, the next step, we try to write all possible terms and arrange all possible terms which may form out of those quantities and arrange them by the number of derivatives of the flow velocity. And then coefficients of these terms will be those transport coefficients which are determined by the underlying microscopic theory. And then, of course, generalized Stokes equations is just conservation law. So an example of this procedure in the case of n equal to 4 Sprang-Mills hydrodynamics is this formula, which is was first obtained by Bhattacharya, Huben, Minvala, and Rangamani, namely the T mu nu up to some factors of nc squared and pi's is given by the following expression. The first piece does not have any derivatives and it's just the perfect fluid part, where we have here the energy density as a function of temperature. Then the second term, we have the shear tensor, which has just a single derivative of the flow velocity. The coefficient is the shear viscosity. And then at second order here, we have tensors with two derivatives or a single second order derivative, and we have more transport coefficients. So basically, at this stage, this is what we know, but the whole derivative expansion could be continued and one could go on and on. So what we wanted to ask in this investigation is what is the nature of this gradient expansion? Suppose we include terms with more and more derivatives, more and more dissipation, then is the resulting series asymptotic? Does it have zero radius of convergence, which is kind of expected? But especially we'd like to see what physics is quantitatively responsible for the lack of convergence. So like in perturbative expansion, these are instantaneous effects or anomalons. So here we'd like to really try to look at this, the same kind of questions, but in a derivative expansion. So the second question would be, if the hydrodynamic series is asymptotic, is it Borel-summable? So can we define in some way Borel-resummed hydrodynamics? So to answer this question, we have to really look at the Borel plane and try to look what kind of singularities may appear on the Borel plane and what is the physical interpretation. So these are kind of theoretical questions which we want to ask. But another motivation, which I will not explore further here, are also some practical issues. Namely, in fact, before starting this investigation, we were mostly inspired by two kind of questions. First of all, Lublinski and Shuyak proposed a kind of resummation of hydrodynamics based on some linearized hydrodynamic modes from ADS-CFT with some phenomenological motivation. But in fact, for us, the main motivation for looking at those higher order terms initially was our previous work on numerical on thermalization in strongly coupled plasma. We considered the evolution of a space-time, which is dual to a plasma system, which evolves from some far from equilibrium initial conditions, and then at some stage starts to be describable by hydrodynamics. And we wanted to analyze when does it happen and what is the features of this transition to hydrodynamics. So in the course of this investigation, of course, this question is motivated by experiment, by Rick and LHC experimentalists, for whom the question when they can run hydrodynamic Monte Carlo codes is very important. And now in this investigation, we found two broad ranges of initial data that we could consider, or initial geometries on the dual side. So we had some kind of large and intermediate initial data or small initial data. And if we look what is the deviation of the evolution from hydrodynamics, from third order hydrodynamics, in this case, we found this type of plot. So on the vertical axis, on the horizontal axis, we have time. On the vertical axis, we have some quantified deviation from third order hydrodynamics. So here we see that we have some non-hydrodynamic degrees of freedom exponentially disappearing, and then we have a very good description in terms of third order hydrodynamics. The deviation is extremely small. And this threshold value, if we move it up or down, it really does not matter. On the other hand, if we look at small initial data, we get this type of picture. So here we have some kind of damping of non-hydrodynamic modes, and then we have some long-powered low tail. So this shows that in here, indeed, some higher order components of hydrodynamics are relevant. So here it's not really easy to quantify where this transition takes place. So we just wanted to try to compute a few more terms in order to have a good understanding of that point. So these are just practical applications. But in this talk, I will concentrate on the theoretical applications which I described on the previous slide. And perhaps the final motivation is really that n equal to 4 Sprang-Mills provides for us, in fact, it seems the only physical systems for which we can really do systematic expansion and compute high orders of gradient expansion. Basically, in all the other systems, we can do like two derivatives, four derivatives, perhaps at most. It's impossible to go on. Well, here we can really do much, much better. So we have a chance of looking at this Borel structure, convergence properties, and in fine detail. Okay, so this is the questions. So now I will move on and describe the method. So we are using here fluid gravity duality, which is the approach pioneered by Bhattacharya, Yachubeni, Mivala, Rangamani. The basic idea that one has is that one starts from a certain boosted planar black hole, which represents a plasma moving uniformly with some velocity and temperature. Then we promote those flow velocity and t to some slow levering function. Then this will no longer be a solution of Einstein's equation, so one has to correct it in the number of derivatives. Therefore, at each stage in this expansion, in the derivative expansion, one looks for a regular solution of a certain equation of this form. We have a linear differential operator acting on the nth order metric and some right-hand side depending on lower orders. So this looks simple, but in fact it's rather complicated to perform the expansion analytically, and in the general case, it was carried out only to the second order, which I showed before, which was really a formidable computation. And in boost invariant case, one could carry it on up to third order, but then no one would want to do the fourth order in this way. However, the main observation here is that in the end, this is really a linear ordinary differential equation. So it's very simple to solve numerically with very high precision. So this is something which is much, much simpler than normal numerical general relativity, which involving solving nonlinear PDEs. So therefore, if we just want to do it numerically and find to a very good precision all those higher order terms, we can really do it efficiently. So we did not do it here in the most generality, but we restricted ourselves to the boost invariant setting. So let me now spend two slides describing the boost invariant setting, what it is. So this came from dates back to Björken's work from 1983, when he made a kind of simplifying assumption of how to describe very highly energetic heavy ion collisions. Namely, if he assumed that the plasma system, which is produced in the collision, should be invariant under longitudinal boosts in the direction of the collision, and if the nuclei are very big, it should not depend on the transverse coordinates. So we just take these assumptions as a kind of simplifying framework, and then the numerous simplifications. First one, we can find that the whole team mu is just expressed in terms of energy density at mid rapidity here. Secondly, the assumptions of symmetry fix uniquely the flow velocity, and the gradient expansion coincides with an expansion in 1 over tau to the 2/3. Moreover, one can see that in each order of this expansion, new transport coefficients appear at each order. So it's really, going to higher orders, we really probe new transport coefficients and higher order dissipative hydrodynamics at each stage. So what is known analytically? So the current result for large tau, so we know four terms. The first term corresponds just to perfect fluid. The second term is first order viscous hydrodynamics. This is shear viscosity. Then here we have second order viscous hydrodynamics and some combinations of the transport coefficients derived by Schwarz, Minvala and collaborators. The fourth term is some third order viscous hydrodynamics. So we see in general we have a series of this form, and at each order new transport coefficients contribute to epsilon n. So in total, currently we have four terms known. So then we applied this numerical solution of this linear ODE from fluid gravity duality, and we obtained 240 coefficients. So we have a sufficiently big series to look at convergence, singularities, and so on. So here the chief complication, in fact, was to generate the right-hand side of equations. This was the most consuming process. And also another thing that we had to have high orders, very high precision computations at each stage, in order to, because it's an iterative procedure, not to lose. So this computation took like 2 weeks, but it was completely automated. So my collaborator left for vacations and came back and got the results. Anyway, if one would be just interested in the first couple of orders, it's very easy and very fast to do. So one can very easily compute a couple of transport coefficients. So now we see that this has a structure of power series in this variable u, which I will call u, which is 1 over tau to the 2/3. So we have this type of perturbative series, and now we can ask all the questions like convergence and singularities. So first of all, for convergence, this is the 1 over n square root of each coefficient. So here we see that we have factorial growth, which is in fact expected, that we have zero radius of convergence. Also, it seems to be an asymptotic series, namely, we see that if we include higher orders, fix some tau, it gets better, and then it gets worse, which is kind of expected. But now we can go on and look at the Borel transform, which is most interesting for us, and try to isolate what kind of singularities appear. So the Borel transform basically consists of factoring out this n factorial behavior. And then, if there are no singularities on the real axis, a Borel summation can be obtained just by integrating, performing this integral here. Now, of course, we cannot just plug this back in here because this series typically has a finite radius of convergence. There are singularities. So in order to probe those singularities, we have to somehow to analytically continue this from the circle of convergence outside to the complex plane. And the standard procedure which is done in this context, in the context of perturbative expansion, is to perform Pade approximations. So we look, therefore, at the zeros of the denominator of the Pade approximant. So we approximate it by rational function and look at the zeros of the denominator to look at the singularities. So what we find is the following structure. So this is the Borel plane, and here we have some kind of singularities. And of course, what is most interesting is the singularities which are closest to zero. So for a long period of time, we tried to, so the closest singularity seems to be the ones here on the negative axis, but we couldn't somehow interpret physically those singularities. But then it turned out that these poles are spurious. Namely, if we look closely at the Pade approximant, then it turns out that here the zeros of the numerator and the zeros of the denominator are almost on top of each other, up to numerical accuracy. Well, up to almost 100 digits in this case. So therefore, these poles are just spurious and they are not there. Perhaps this pole also is kind of suspect, but those poles are definitely real. So the structure is as follows. So first of all, what we see, we not see isolated poles, but we really see branch cuts on the Borel plane. And those branch points here, they set the radius of convergence of the Borel transform, and it's also consistent with this factorial growth and the perfactor, which I showed before for the expansion. Another issue is that we see that we do not see any poles on the real axis, so this suggests that the Borel summation of this derivative expansion in the nuclear force parameters should in fact be possible. So now I would like to address the question, what is the physical interpretation of these branch cut singularities here? So first let us look at those branch points, the beginnings of those cuts. So to see what is the interpretation, the easiest thing to do is to take the inverse Borel transform and deform the contour of integral, so for it to encircle just the single pole here, and look what comes out. Then we see that the pole at the edge of the cut will contribute as an exponential of this form with tau to the 2/3 exponent. So now this is somewhat vaguely familiar, looks like quasi-normal modes, but with some, so this number is a bit different, and also we have this tau to the 2/3 scaling here instead of just tau, which is common for quasi-normal modes of a static black hole. However, in fact, it is really the first lowest non-hydrodynamic quasi-normal mode. One can make a direct link with the ordinary scalar quasi-normal mode of the planar black hole just by looking at the following. So this is the value of the planar black hole quasi-normal mode found first by Horowitz-Hubene and Andrei Starinets. So this gets multiplied usually by the temperature times time. But now the temperature here is moving, so we have to integrate T of tau d tau. So we get an integral of 1 over tau to the 1/3, so we get a factor of 3/2 and tau to the 2/3 here. And if we multiply by 3/2 this number, we get this number, and we see that it's up to four digits, the same as the position of the singularity in the Borel plane. So somehow it's really quite fascinating that, well, one would expect, of course, that non-hydrodynamic modes would be responsible for the breakdown of convergence, but it's quite fascinating that this hydrodynamic expansion really captures extremely fine details of those hydrodynamic modes. Now we may ask, what is the nature, what is the interpretation of the whole branch cut? That was just the endpoint. So one possibility would be, of course, quasi-normal modes depend on the momentum. So one could think that we have this set of for many momenta, we'll get a kind of linear superposition of singularities. However, it is not the case. Here, in the case of the boost invariant setup, only momentum equal to zero contributes. So, in order to understand what happens, we can again deform the contour of the inverse Borel transform and pick up the contribution from not from the just endpoint, but from a significant part of this cut. And then we can look at the large tau behavior, and we'll see that we get, in addition to this exponential factor, which we had before, we get in addition a power law prefactor. And this power law prefactor is absent in normal, quasi-normal modes of an ordinary black hole. However, here we have to remember that, in fact, the late-time geometry is not just the boosted black hole, but the corrections from viscosity, namely the first gradient corrections to the expanding black hole. And if we now do the analysis of quasi-normal modes for this geometry, we'll find indeed that we have a prefactor in the quasi-normal mode, and which is power law-like. And again, we see that we have like now 3 digits agreement with the exponents here and with the power law here. So the bottom line of this investigation here is that really high order viscous hydrodynamics expansion encodes really very fine details of the non-hydrodynamic degrees of freedom which appear in the theory. Okay, so now I will conclude. So first of all, we calculated the gradient expansion to very high orders. As expected, this has zero radius of convergence. However, the singularities in the Borel plane are first of all cuts, and they have clear physical origin, so they're really, one can explicitly pinpoint that these are really lowest non-hydrodynamic modes, degrees of freedom appearing in the dual description. So this is so all this is kind of an analogy with perturbative expansion in quantum field theory, instanton effects. So now here, instead of instanton effects, we have those non-hydrodynamic degrees of freedom appropriately deformed by the evolving geometry. So by viscous shear viscosity corrections to the dynamics. And really, it's really on a very quantitative level. Also, we did not find poles on the real axis, suggesting the existence of a Borel resummation. On the more practical side, it is really fairly easy to compute numerically high transport coefficients, because here one can just solve ordinary differential equations, which is simple things to do. And finally, one can apply this data for some practical purposes. But the bottom line, I would say, is that really there's this intricate interplay between gradient expansion and those other parts of Einstein's equations. And it will be perhaps very interesting to understand, like analytically, in some sense, why this works, because all this comes from Einstein's equations. But we are looking at Einstein's equations from two different points of view. One point of view is making a derivative expansion. Another point of view is looking at quasi-normal modes. And somehow there's very intricate, kind of they're intertwined together in a consistent manner. So in a way, it's a mathematical problem, so which is very difficult, but perhaps one could solve it. But physically, it's extremely consistent and very kind of aesthetically pleasing for us that one really sees and everything seems to be consistent like that. Okay, thank you very much.
Yes.
Yeah, so I have two brief questions. So is there any asymptotic formula one can think of in order to express the number of transport coefficients as a function of the order? Then the second question is, the metric that you are considering, this boosted black hole solution with coordinate dependence, velocity and temperature, it's not a solution of Einstein equation, but can one think of some effective deformed theory of gravity where this metric could be some asymptotic solution?
Okay, so concerning the first question, we are wondering about that, namely that perhaps the origin of this fractal growth may be just like a number of Feynman diagrams, like in, so it's extremely natural to think about that, but we didn't really pinpoint that, we didn't try to do combinatorics to enumerate, but it would be very interesting to do whether it comes from just many coefficients of order one or something happens simultaneously. Now, here, I guess it's very difficult to go away from to find a theory which would be only completely hydrodynamics. Here, in a way, this what we saw, these singularities on the Borel plane, really explicitly show that something is missing, right? So just even in hydrodynamics, just doing hydrodynamic expansion, gradient expansion, we see that we have to add those quasi-normal modes. So we have to somehow complete this hydrodynamic expansion by non-hydrodynamics degrees of freedom, I guess. So that's, and also, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
More questions?
Do you see any sign of the second quasi-normal mode in your results?
Well, the second quasi-normal mode, it's kind of it was around here, so it's very close. It's close to this cut, so it's not, as far as I remember, it's not clear whether. I guess it will be around here, but as you see. Here, I would say that we do not really believe too much. Kind of those points. So what we can confidently be sure about, I would say, is this closest part. The rest may be kind of changed if we modify the pattern approximation to do some different kinds of analytical continuation. So we did not really check the robustness of that.
But if you could go to higher order and do you expect new branch cuts starting at each quasi-normal?
Yes. So if one would do it to infinite order, really one should see here branch cuts for all quasi-normal modes appearing. Definitely. So this is definitely the structure which is expected.
More questions, comments? Please.
So usually the transport coefficient is assumed to be constant in the conventional expansion, but in the so-called non-Newtonian fluid, the for example shear viscosity can depend on the gradient of the fluid velocity. So this kind of nature might be obtained by resumming the higher order corrections. So do you have any comment about that, or have you ever tried to see?
Yeah. So it's very interesting. In fact, indeed. So we were thinking a bit about trying to implement this kind of resummation. We are not sure for the moment what would be the optimal way. But definitely, this type of reasoning may be extremely useful there. So in a way, having those big powers, it's good to try to indeed guess the structure, right? Do a partial resummation, what is the most natural way, but we do not know the answer to that yet. Because it may be also phenomenologically interesting. I mean, because then one could formulate kind of resummed hydrodynamics, which already incorporates part of the structure.
Yeah. One more question. Okay, if not, let's thank the speaker again.